Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us here together to this place today to learn principles of music. We do pray you'd give us open hearts, ready minds to understand the issues that we face in our modern world, and that we might be willing to follow your counsel. We pray your blessing on each listener, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We have entitled our music seminar, Audio Invasion, The Unseen Enemy Within. Back in 2011, Blaze News, which is a conservative, multi-platform news agency in America, had this article entitled, Worship Wars is the Worst Fight in Your Church Over the Style of Music. This is, of course, in the context of Protestant churches in America. And the article said there's a war brewing inside of U.S. churches. While some congregants prefer the beat-bopping sounds of electric guitars, drums, and fast-paced tunes, others seek a more traditional worship experience. And you have no doubt been to both types of worship services, even within our own denomination. The divide, which often hinges upon age and personal music taste, only seems to be intensifying, especially as churches seek to modernize and attract younger audiences. The issues that we face here in Kenya and in Africa are not just local to this continent. They are global issues. We face these issues in Europe. We face them in America. We face them in Asia. And this Protestant article is outlining that issue. According to the USA Today, nearly 50% of Protestant churches are now reporting that they use electric guitars or drums during worship. Somebody told me just yesterday, they were in a church here in Nairobi, and they had a live drum set right there on the stage in the front of the audience. This proportion has grown from 35% back in 2000, according to a 2010 Faith Communities Today study of 14,000 congregations across America. These are Protestant churches across America. Pastor David Cloud, this is not an Adventist pastor, he's just a Protestant pastor, believes that drifting away from traditional worship may have spiritual side effects. He says there is an intense war being waged today for the heart and soul of Bible-believing churches. And one of the devil's most effective Trojan horses is music, he says. And I would agree with his conclusion. A few years later, in 2016, Christianity Today, which is one of the most well-respected Christian publications in America, had an article entitled, The Waning of the Worship Wars. In other words, the fighting has diminishing. The wars are waning, which simply means that contemporary worldly music and worship styles have won the war. We're not fighting over it anymore. And it seems like it's almost that way even within our own church. But the article says this, there has been a decades-long trend in American religion, away from an emphasis on belief and doctrine, and toward an emphasis on experience. Don't tell me what the Bible says. I want to feel my faith. In other words, emotion and the search for a least common denominator kind of worship. So let's put away all of our doctrines, and let's just get along, and we'll love each other, they're saying. Here is an interesting diagram that the article showed. You can see the percentage point change in selected worship services from 1998 to 2012. Singing by a choir has dropped by 9%. A bulletin or a program at church worship has dropped 10%. Projection equipment has gone up 23%. We got it here. We're using projection equipment. Testimony from members is up to 7%. And that's okay as long as it's in the right context. But when somebody stands up in church services and interrupts the service and says, I have a testimony from the Holy Spirit. Well, it's up. That's up in churches. Saying amen has gone up 6%. Nothing wrong with that. Amen. Jumping or shouting has increased by 8% in churches. Wow. Raising hands in praise has gone up 14%. Have you noticed that even in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? When we like whatever the choir sang or whatever the magician presented, what do? We're doing the same thing as the Pentecostals. Applause has increased 10%. You don't hear that too much in Adventist churches, but I have heard it, and it's growing. Using drums. Please notice the use of drums has gone up 14% in church worship. Using the organ has dropped 11%. That's the trend in Christian churches across the board. Doesn't matter the denomination. And so Christianity Today says, the worship wars are waning, they're declining. Contemporary worldly music and worship styles have essentially won the war. And my question for you is, what about the Seventh-day Adventist Church? That is why we're having this workshop today called Audio Invasion, the Unseen Enemy Within. And I thank those who organize this. We actually present these principles to our classes that I share and I preach. And someone said, this is something that I want my church members to hear too. So they organized this particular music seminar today on this holiday. In our workshop, we're going to look at a number of things. First of all, in this first presentation, we'll be looking at music and mood. How the music we listen to actually determines our emotions and drives our hormones. Then in the next class, we'll be looking at drumming up demons. We'll look at the origin of the drum and the drum beat. Then in the following class, the third class, we'll look at the rhythm of rebellion, the bad attitude that is coming into popular music. Then our fourth class, we'll look at worldly worship, how to distinguish worldly styles in worship music. And then our fifth class will be music samples. We'll look at a variety of music samples, and we'll let you'll be the judges, and we'll take time for questions and answers. And I should mention right here, if you have questions as we go along, write them down somewhere on your notes so that whenever we do our last class, we do questions and answers, you'll have that ready to ask, because we'll just go right along until the last presentation for the Q&A. In our first class, music and mood, how music affects emotions and character. 19-year-old Patty Hearst was the daughter of a wealthy family that owned a chain of newspapers, magazines, radio stations, television stations across America. Very wealthy family. She was, at the age of 19, engaged to be married to Stephen Weed. But on February 4, 1974, Patty Hearst's life changed forever, never to be the same. It was about 9 o'clock in the evening, there in their apartment in Berkeley, California. They heard a knock at the door. And before they could get to the door was broken open, and in rushed a group of the Siamese Liberation Army. A group of both men and women. These were sort of like the terrorists back then. They were anti-government. They were heavily armed. They beat up Patty's boyfriend. They tied up the 19-year-old Patty Hearst, threw her into the back of a car, the boot of a car, and took off. They had kidnapped Patty Hearst. And they began making some very amazing demands of her family for her release. Multiplied millions of dollars were demanded. Patty Hearst was locked in a closet for 57 days. She was blindfolded, she was gagged, she was abused, she was raped. And after 2 months in that closet, she was finally given an ultimatum. Either you join our little terrorist group, the Siamese Liberation Army, or we'll kill you. So Patty Hearst joined the Army. You can see a picture of her here with her machine gun in front of their flag, the Siamese Liberation Army flag. And within a few days, she was with the Army, with that little group, helping to rob a bank. You can see Patty Hearst there with her machine gun. This is from one of the cameras there in the bank. This is a bank robbery. How was Patty Hearst converted from being a respectable young lady to becoming a terrorist, a bank robber? How was she converted? Newsweek magazine had an article on her conversion. This was back in 1976, after they had finally caught her. She spent some time in prison. She was later released. They wrote a biography on her experience. And Dr. William Sargent, Britain's foremost expert on brainwashing, examined Patty Hearst. He says, quote, "She was an unwilling victim of a forced conversion or brainwashing. God wants a willing conversion. The devil is after a forced conversion." According to Sargent, a person whose nervous system is under constant pressure can inhibit and exhibit paradoxical brain activity. Bad becomes good and vice versa. You can see the conversion here. And that, Sargent argues, is precisely what happened to Patty. She was converted. Bad became good, good became bad. How was she converted? He said, her nervous system was kept at maximum stress by the continual playing of loud rock music. You might say, well, I like that music. Well, yeah, you might like that music, but you can see what it does to your nervous system. Maximum stress, and as a result, she was converted. Can the music that you listen to change your character? The answer is yes. And that was documented centuries ago. In fact, Aristotle, back in BC, said this: if a person habitually listens to the kind of music that rouses ignoble, that's base, shameful, vile passions, his whole character will be shaped into ignoble form. He becomes a vile person, in other words. Emotions of any kind are produced by melody and rhythm. Therefore, by music, a man becomes accustomed to feeling the right emotions. Music has thus the power to form character. You probably never thought that your music would actually affect your formation of character, but it does. You let me listen to the kind of music that's on your phone, and I will give you a pretty good clue of what kind of character you have, because your music shapes your character. He said, Aristotle said, in short, if one listens to the wrong kind of music, he will become the wrong kind of person. But conversely, if he listens to the right kind of music, he will tend to become the right kind of person. Which brings me to this question. Is it possible to listen to the wrong kind of music without knowing that it's the wrong kind of music? Is that possible? Very much so. Here's an example. This is Christian children's music. Anybody recognize that tune? I see some. I'll put the words to it later and you'll get an idea what it is. So people listen to that music not even recognizing that it's not good music. And as a result, the character is changed. We are told there is great power in music. And we don't often recognize the great power that is inherent in music. Music directly affects our emotions, which is what makes it so powerful. In fact, here's from Family Weekly, which says it's really a powerful drug. Music can poison you, lift your spirits, or make you sick without knowing why. That's why they play music at the movies. Now you tell me. Do they change the music of the movie based upon the continent where the movie will be played? Do they have different music for Chinese and for Americans and for Africans, or is the music the same in the movie? It's the same, because they know that wherever you play that movie, that music will have the same effect upon the audience, whether it's an African audience, an Asian audience, a Chinese audience, an American audience. They know that. Music is used to shape your emotions. Dr. Leonard Bernstein, one of the most famous conductors who ever lived, said this: music is something terribly special. It doesn't have to pass through the sensor of the brain before it can reach the heart. You tell me, what is the sensor of the brain? Anybody know? That's the frontal lobe. That's the sensor of your brain. That's where your judgment, your reasoning, your belief system resides. And music doesn't have to pass through the frontal lobe before it directly affects our hormones. It affects our limbic system, which controls our hormones. And that's why Leonard Bernstein says an F sharp doesn't have to be considered in the mind. It's a direct hit. And therefore, all the more powerful. Music affects your emotions, whether you know it or not. That's why Dr. Neil Nedley, highly acclaimed Adventist doctor in America, says this: music enters the brain through its emotional regions, which include the temporal lobe and limbic system. Here you can see the temporal lobe. That's where your auditory sensations are, your sound, language, and so forth. But it also directly affects the limbic system, which controls your hormones. That's why the music that you listen to affects your emotions. He says from there, that's from the temporal lobe, some kinds of music tend to produce a frontal lobe response that influences the will, moral worth, and reasoning power. I'll give you an example. We would consider this as elevating music. Where's my sound man? We need to turn up the sound a little bit, I think. You listen to that kind of music? Do you feel like dancing? How about snapping your fingers? How about tapping your foot? Do you feel like relaxing? Do you feel like maybe taking a nap? It's okay. Do you sleep? I understand you had a hard night maybe last night. But that very style of music is so restful. That's elevating music. And then he says other kinds of music will evoke very little, if any, frontal lobe response, but will produce a large emotional response with very little logical or moral interpretation. An example. How about now? You feel like snapping your fingers? Feel like moving? It's starting to move our emotions. That is a Christian piece, or a quote Christian piece. Why? Because the music affects our emotions. You listen to the previous piece, you feel relaxed, rested. You listen to that piece, you feel like getting up and moving. Music is made up of three things. Those of you that know music, you know these three things. It's made up of melody, harmony, and rhythm. Now, it is true, there are some forms of music that we wouldn't really call music. It really doesn't fit into this category. For example, rap. Rap has no melody, typically, no harmony. It's just all rhythm, but it's called music. But real music has melody, harmony, and rhythm. Dr. Frank Garlock, who is a doctor of music, he's written a book, Music in the Balance. In that book, he says melody speaks to the spirit. That's the worshipful experience. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. That's the melody. Harmony speaks to the mind, the intellect. Rhythm speaks to the body, the flesh. Melody, harmony, rhythm. And that's why Paul says in Galatians 5, verse 17, for the flesh lusts against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other. Do you want to feed the flesh or the spirit? Jesus said in John 3, verses 6 and 7, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. So in order to enjoy music that has melody and harmony, I have to be born again. If I am not born again, I'm going to desire music that feeds the flesh. Music that speaks to the flesh or speaks to the body, that makes me want to move. Melody speaks to the spirit. Harmony speaks to the mind. Rhythm speaks to the body or the flesh. I give an example. And I want you to notice the progression in this piece. This is going to be the exact same song all the way through. Most famous Christian hymn. Does that seem worshipful? Spiritual. Is it spiritual? Yes. Yes or no?
Then sings my soul, my Savior God.
Any change? You feel like moving a little bit now? Maybe swaying? Same song. That's jazz. Same song. Soft rock.
God, his son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in.
Dead on the cross, and my burden gladly bearing.
Still feel like sitting still? What's this speaking to you now more? Classic rock. What's it speaking to? Rhythm speaks to the body. Same words. But you can certainly hear the rhythm. The question of music, this is from Carlo Manos, Christians in Music. He says, the question of music, that's what we're looking at today in this whole day, the question of music. The question of music being what may be called an upper division topic demands a great deal of spiritual maturity. If I am born of the Spirit, then I probably have enough spiritual maturity to be able to distinguish. If I am not yet born of the Spirit, will I be able to distinguish good music from bad music? Probably not. It demands a great deal of spiritual maturity, music. For as Paul says, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. If I'm not a spiritual person, I want music that speaks to the flesh. It requires a great deal of spiritual maturity to distinguish the music of Zion from the music of Babylon. Now, there's a text. You can mark this in your notes, those of you that are taking notes, from Psalms 137, verses 1 to 4. Psalms 137, verses 1 to 4, says this. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps, not our drums. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How? How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Now I want to answer that question. By the way, I should back up for a moment. The songs of Zion, the Lord's songs, you can find in the hymnal. Full of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song, Lord's songs, in a strange land? I want to answer that question with this question. Why? Instead of how, why? Why should we sing the Pentecostals' songs with the music of Babylon, the beat of the street, in our church? That's the question to consider. Those of you that are over 30, if you're 30 and over, you know, you can remember back 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when the music we now hear in many Adventist churches was not allowed. You know that. Something has been changing. We're following the Pentecostals in their music. And so here this worship leader says the question of music demands a great deal of spiritual maturity. Has the music of Babylon with the beat of the street slipped unrecognized into our churches? What do you think? Or maybe into our phones or into our cars? I'm going to give you an example. This is actually a Seventh-day Adventist choir singing. To Seventh-day Adventists. That's where we're headed. We might not be dancing quite that much yet here in Kenya, but we're headed that way. It's crept into our church, and so we are considering today in this workshop the unseen enemy within, audio invasion. Family Weekly said, music is used everywhere to condition the human mind. What is music being used for? To condition the human mind. It can be, I put down, it is, just as powerful as a drug and much more dangerous because nobody takes musical manipulation very seriously. Nobody thinks about how the music that I listen to affects my emotions and my character. Here's what Jimi Hendrix said. He was the leader of a hugely popular psychedelic rock band in the 60s and 70s. He says, you can hypnotize people with music. And when you get them at their weakest point, you can preach into their subconscious what we want to say. Now tell me, what part of music is you can hypnotize people with? Is it the melody? Is it the harmony? Is it the rhythm? It's the rhythm that hypnotizes people. And that's why Jimi Hendrix says you can use that music to hypnotize people, and then you speak to them whatever you want to preach to them. Rhythm, this is from Joseph Michaelis. Rhythm is the element of music most closely allied to body movement, to physical action. Is that true? Melody speaks to the spirit. Harmony speaks to the intellect, the mind. Rhythm speaks to the body, the flesh. And so here it says, rhythm is the element of music most closely allied to body movement, to physical action. That's why when there's too much rhythm in the music, we want to start responding. We want to start moving. Its simple patterns, when repeated over and over, can have a hypnotic effect on us. That's the rhythms. There is great power in music. And we often don't realize the power of music. Discovery News said a study had participants listen to music while being scanned by an fMRI machine. This was scanning their brain waves, the brain patterns. The researchers found that the brain released dopamine, that's the feel-good hormone. The brain released dopamine both in anticipation of hearing music and while listening to music. So when you listen to the music, then your hormones are being manipulated. Dopamine, the feel-good hormone. The reaction was similar to the reactions in the brain that occur from drug and sex addicts. And music can be addicting. The findings will hopefully reveal more about brain chemistry and further the study of what? Addictions. Before I was a Christian, I was addicted to rock and roll. This was in the 70s. And I'm amazed at the very same beats that I used to listen to when I was in the world in the 70s, I am now hearing today in church. Same rhythms. I was addicted to those rhythms. And have you noticed how some people, when they're out on their motorcycle, these motorcycle riders, drivers, they got to take their drug with them, even on the motorcycle. And you can hear it. Here comes the motorcycle. And it's not the engine you're hearing. It's the boom, 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 boom. The music. And you've seen people that have these things stuck in their ears all day long, wherever they go. They're feeding their addiction. What is it that is addictive? What element of the music is the addictive part? The rhythm speaks to the body. Steven Tyler from the rock group Aerosmith said, rock music is the strongest drug in the world. And now we bring it into church. Some of you have it on your phones. And so that's why we have this class entitled Music and Mood. Now, do you tell me, can you alter your mood with drugs? Yes. Can you alter your mood with music? Yes. Jennifer Robinson says, music can make me feel tense or relaxed. It can disturb, unsettle me, and startle me. That was a Christian group. Music can disturb, unsettle me, startle me. It can calm me down or excite me. Let's have some calming music. Does that calm you? You could sit down and listen to that music and you would be lowering your stress hormones. You would feel more relaxed. In fact, they say after a hard day, a stressful day at work, if you come home and listen to that kind of music, you just feel so good. Calms you. Here is from the book, How to Conquer the Addiction to Rock Music. One of the most powerful releases of the fight or flight adrenaline high. That's the stress hormone, adrenaline. When you are in a crisis, you can feel the adrenaline rush. One of the most powerful releases of the fight or flight adrenaline high is music, which is discordant in its beats or chords. The music we just listened to was calming. The music before that, well, that would stimulate the stress hormone. Good music follows exact mathematical rules, which cause the mind to feel comforted, encouraged, and safe. I want you to click save in your mental computer on this particular statement. We're going to come back to this in a moment. But just remember that. One of the most powerful releases of the fight or flight adrenaline high is music that is discordant in its beats or chords. With that in background, we're going to come back to that. Consider these studies. Listening to classical chorale. There's the study listed. Meditative, there's the study, and folk music, there's the study, has been shown to induce significant reductions of cortisol values in healthy adults. You can ask the doctors here, what is cortisol? That's the stress hormone, the fight or flight hormone, cortisol. Whereas significant increases in cortisol, significant increases, were noted in listeners who were exposed to techno, there's the study, and upbeat pop and rock music, there's the study, which is what most of our music is today. In fact, even some of our music in church is that kind of music. You listen to that kind of music, what happens to your cortisol? Significantly increased. Now, if you think cortisol is good for you, listen again. You have to have a certain level of cortisol to have the energy to function. But when that cortisol starts going up into the higher range, then you have all sorts of health problems. Cortisol, this is Psychology Today, cortisol, why the stress hormone is public enemy number one. The stress hormone cortisol is public health enemy number one. Scientists have known for years that elevated cortisol levels, if it's too high, interfere with learning and memory, lower immune function and bone density, increase weight gain, blood pressure, cholesterol, heart disease. The list goes on and on. And yes, it does go on and on. I have here in my notes 15 other dangerous health factors, health results of too much cortisol. It actually creates free radicals, which kill brain cells. Too much cortisol. Chronic stress and elevated cortisol levels also increase the risk for depression, mental illness, and lower life expectancy. So you can actually shorten or lengthen your life just by the music you choose to listen to. I tell people, cortisol, the stress hormone, it shortens your life. When you drink a cup of coffee, you're increasing your cortisol. That's why you feel stimulated. People need that stimulation in the morning to get going in the day, and so they drink their coffee. And I tell people, when you're drinking that cup of coffee, just think about this. I'm drinking a cup of aging. I'm going to help myself get older quicker. Now, if you're a young person, you might want to get older quicker. But for most of us, if you're over 25, you don't want to get any older quicker. But when you drink your cup of tea, because tea has caffeine in it too, you're elevating your cortisol. And anything that elevates cortisol shortens your life. Which you can see here, even music elevates your cortisol. This week, two separate studies were published in Science linking elevated cortisol levels as a potential trigger for what? Mental illness and decreased resilience, especially in adolescence. What is adolescence? I see we have some adolescents here. An adolescent is a teenager. If you're between the ages of 13 and 19, you are in adolescence. And when you have elevated cortisol in adolescence, that's going to increase your risk for what? Mental illness. Please remember, significant increases in cortisol when listening to upbeat pop and rock music. The words don't matter. Whether you like or dislike the music does not matter either. I'll give you an example. This is a Christian piece. Good words. You You listen to that? Up goes your cortisol. It's the beat, the rhythm, which science tells us increases cortisol. And whenever you increase cortisol, you're increasing your risk for mental illness. Chronic stress and elevated cortisol levels also increase the risk for depression, mental illness, especially in adolescence. The World Health Organization states depression is the number one cause of illness and disability in adolescents worldwide. Why? Well, one reason is the music that young people are listening to.
Yeah, man, I see you over there, so hypnotic.
The beat
thinking about what I do
increases cortisol.
I get you like, ooh, baby, baby, ooh, baby, baby.
You might like that music, but you are increasing your risk for depression by listening to that. And that's why Psychology Today says high school and college students are 5 to 8 times as likely to suffer from depressive symptoms as were teenagers 50 or 60 years ago. Why? 50 or 60 years ago, could you take your music with you on your iPad, your iPod? They didn't even have digital music 50 years ago. Rock music was just starting to come in, and you had to have it on a record player, and you couldn't just take that with you everywhere. You had to go to somebody that had a record player to listen to the classic rock of the 50s and the 60s. People tell me all the time, well, that's just your personal opinion. Well, if it's a personal opinion, science now is verifying the effects, regardless of your opinion. Chronic stress, elevated cortisol levels increase the risk for depression. Did you know, according to a study by the Duke University, the likelihood of major depression among Pentecostals was 3 times greater than persons with other affiliations? Tell me why. What kind of music do you hear at virtually all Pentecostal worship services? You hear Christian rock. Words are good, but it's rock music with the words. And rock music increases your cortisol, which increases your risk for depression, which is why Pentecostals have 3 times more risk of depression. Significant increases in cortisol when listening to upbeat pop and rock music. And again, I remind you, the words don't matter. Whether you like or dislike the music does not matter either. Your cortisol is going up. When your cortisol goes up, then. At Louisiana State University, researchers found that listening to hard-driving rock music increased the heart rates as well as lowered the quality of physical workouts in a group of 24 young adults. These are young adults. When calming music was played, their heart rates lowered, which allowed for longer training sessions. That's why now in sports, there are some sports people that are changing their music from pop music to classical music just so they can win the game. A Temple University researcher study on the effects of rock music showed that university students exposed to recordings by the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, the Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin, breathed faster, had reduced skin resistance to stimuli, and had an increased heart rate compared to those exposed to background noise. When you walk along the street on a busy day, the noise increases your stress, stress hormone. Cortisol goes up. But when you listen to pop music, it goes up even more than just background noise. John Hopkins researchers found that listening to rock music caused people to eat faster. Why? Because they're stressed. And to eat a larger volume of food. Classical music, especially slow string music, makes them eat more slowly and consume less. So if you want to lose weight, this might help. Just change your music. You'll eat less. You'll eat more slowly. Now, with all that background, we're coming back to that statement. Remember, you were supposed to click save in your mental computer? One of the most powerful releases of the fight or flight adrenaline high is music that is discordant in its beats or chords. Good music follows exact mathematical rules, which cause the mind to feel comforted, encouraged, and safe. Musicians have found that when they go against these rules, the listener experiences an addictive high. What causes the addiction? It's the music, but what part of the music? The melody, the harmony, the rhythm. It's the rhythm. As in all addiction, victims become tolerant. The same music that once created a pleasant tingle of excitement no longer satisfies. The rhythm, that's what is addictive. And so we're not satisfied with the soft rock. We want something harder. The music must become more jarring, louder, and more discordant. One starts with soft rock, then rock and roll, then on up to heavy metal music. What does that do for the brain? Well, it interferes with learning, increases your risk of depression. I want you to consider with me today how music affects learning. For you young people here, listen. This was an experiment done by a 16-year-old. 16-year-old David Merrill thought that the loud sounds of hard rock music must have a bad effect on its devoted fans and came up with a way to test that damage. Merrill got 72 mice and divided them into three groups. One to test a mouse's response to hard rock, another to the music of Mozart. What kind of music is that? Classical music, and a control group that wouldn't listen to any music at all, rock or classical. The young visionary got all the mice accustomed to living in aquariums in his basement, then started playing music 10 hours a day. That's an average for a teenager. 10 hours a day, my music is always on. Merrill put each mouse through a maze three times a week that originally had taken the mice an average of 10 minutes to complete. So they had to find their way through the maze to the food. When they started, all three groups, it took them 10 minutes to find their way through the maze to where the food was. Over time, the 24 control group mice managed to cut about 5 minutes from their maze completion time. They're not listening to any music. But just by practice, they started with 10, they've cut off 5 minutes, so how long does it take them to get from the start to the food? 5 minutes. The Mozart listening to mice cut their time back 8.5 minutes. They started with 10, they cut off 8.5 minutes. How long does it take the Mozart, the classical music mice, to get from the start to the food? How long? 1.5 minutes. But the hard rock mice added 20 minutes to their time, making their average maze running time 300% more than their original average. Need we say more? Well, maybe we do. Merrill told the Associated Press that he'd attempted the experiment the year before, allowing mice in the different groups to live together. I had to cut my project short because all the hard rock mice killed each other because of the stress from the music. Merrill said, none of the classical mice did that. These are just dumb mice. What did the hard rock music mice do? They started out with 10 minutes. They added another 20 minutes. So how long is it taking them to get from the start to the food? 30 minutes. The classical music mice, how long? 1.5 minutes. Yeah, your heart might be beating louder than your head, but you're not learning. When you listen to pop music, you are making learning 300% harder. than if you listen to classical music. The Mozart listening to mice, they cut their time back 8.5 minutes, 1.5 minutes to get to the food. People say, oh, but Pastor, I don't like that music. It has no beat, no stimulation. I want you to consider the SAT scores in college in America. When you go to college, you have to take an SAT test, Scholastic Assessment Test. Here's all the pop music. You can see where the people place themselves. Please notice who is out ahead of everybody else. What kind of music is Beethoven? Classical. You want to be intelligent? Here is a picture of at least what was then the smartest person in the world. This is Kim Ung-young with an IQ of 210%. That's a smart Korean. At the age of 2, he knew 4 foreign languages at the age of 2. By the age of 3, he knew algebra. By the age of 8, he had graduated from university. Nobody could teach him anymore because he was just so smart. Smart Korean. When we used to travel to Asia, I loved to fly through the Incheon Airport. When you fly into the airport in Seoul, Korea, guess what kind of music they're playing all through that vast airport? Classical music. Smart Koreans. When I fly into Asia, when I fly into America, guess what? Rock. Pop music. Even science will tell you that classical music is much better for intellect. It's better for learning. It reduces your cortisol. Now, in its strictest sense, classical music is the music of the classical era. But in its broadest sense, classical music is music that has melody, harmony, and rhythm, but the rhythm you don't really notice. Classical music, the rhythm, the beat, it's there, but you don't hear it. You don't notice it. However, in pop music, the rhythm is a distinctive part of the music. You can't help but notice it. Is the rhythm there? Do you recognize that piece? Why are you smiling? You can't help but miss that. And you can't miss the beat there. That's Christian rock. Doctors Daniel and Bernadette, their studies have proven that any music, whatever the, if you call it Christian or whatever, any music that contains pounding low frequencies, we just had an example, like the ones we hear at the airports, construction sites, is considered to be a brain drain. Rock, hip-hop, and pop music, we had an example, falls into this category because of the driving bass guitar and other low-pounding sounds. Music that contains high frequencies, this is from another doctor, helps the brain recharge. The higher the frequency, the more the brain is recharged, between 5,000 and 8,000 hertz. The music of Mozart, for example, contains more of these frequencies than other composers. That's classical music. Now, I want to answer this question. This is a common question. Is music neutral? Here's from Dr. Max Schuen. Music is the most powerful stimulus known among the perceptive senses. The medical, psychiatric, and other evidence for the non-neutrality of music is so overwhelming that it frankly amazes me that anyone should seriously say otherwise. The National Academy of Sciences states music recruits neural systems of reward and emotion similar to those that are artificially activated by drugs of abuse. So in other words, the music activates your hormones. That's what makes you feel the way you do. You like your music because, well, it's stimulating. David Tam says, there is scarcely a single function of the body which cannot be affected by musical tones. The roots of the auditory nerves are more widely distributed and possess more extensive connections than those of any other nerves in the body. Investigation has shown that music affects digestion, internal secretions, circulation, nutrition, and respiration, pretty much all about you. Even neural networks of the brain have been found to be sensitive to harmonic principles. There is great power in music. Let me share with you a statement from Ellen White. The things you have described, the Lord has shown me would take place just before the close of probation. That every uncouth thing will be demonstrated. There will be shouting with drums, music, and dancing. She's not describing the disco. She's not describing the Pentecostals. She's describing what she saw in vision happening in some Seventh-day Adventist churches. Remember the Adventist dance choir we saw earlier? The senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. And this is called the moving of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit never reveals itself in such methods, in such a bedlam of noise. This is an invention of Satan to cover up his ingenious methods for making of none effect the pure, sincere, elevating, ennobling, sanctifying truth for this time. A bedlam of noise shocks the senses and perverts that which, if conducted aright, might be a blessing. The powers of satanic agencies blend with the din and noise to have a carnival, and this is termed the Holy Spirit's working. Who is working here? The powers of satanic agencies, he says. That brings us to the question, where did the drumbeat come from? Is it just part of our culture? Or is there a darker side to the beat of the street which you find in almost all music today? We're going to answer that in our next class. Drumming up demons.